You are listening to another Clarkesworld Magazine podcast with your host and narrator, Kate Baker. Greetings, Clarkesworld citizens. I hope this podcast finds you extraordinarily well. This is our second story for October 2023, issue 205. I hope that you've enjoyed the stories thus far, whether this is your first or somewhere just under 1,000. Thank you for your ongoing support. Thank you for telling a friend. Thank you for your monetary support. Thank you for going to patreon.com/Clarkesworld to help us make back some of the income that we've lost with Amazon making some horrendous changes yet again. So, with that said, our story is titled The Blaumilch by Lavie Tidhar. Lavie Tidhar is author of Usama, The Violent Century, A Man Lies Dreaming, Central Station, Unholy Land, By Force Alone, The Hood, The Escapement, Neom, and Maror. His latest novels are Adama and The Circumference of the World. His award includes the World Fantasy and British Fantasy Awards, the John W. Campbell Award, the Newcom Prize, and the Jerwood Prize, and he has been shortlisted for the Clark Award and the Philip K. Dick Award. If you like what you hear, you can go back to Junk Hounds, Rain Falling in the Pines, Blue and Blue and Blue and Pink, Venus and Bloom, and Governor. So, my dear listener, I hope you can sit back, relax, and let me tell you a story. Outside Yen of town, beyond the dome, on the dirt track that led onto Enid, there was a small camp of Martian reborn, a clump of beat-up caravans, a couple of old oxygen generators, a spliced water main pirated off the main line. A small chapel for the Emperor of Time sat forlorn in what was once a metal drum, the size of a small house, salvaged from an abandoned biofuel facility near Port Jessup. Inside, it was a much patched-together Kawamata Chiaki deck that offered the reborn access to the Mars that never was. For power, the dwellers of that encampment in the desert harvested solar and seeded wind turbines. For money, they brewed water of life and cheap vodka to sell to the Izikayas and Shebeens of the nearby towns, and hired out as day laborers in the bug farms, eye deity factories, and underground fish tanks that provided the towns of the outback with nutrition and faith. But most of the time, the reborn, inevitably young, male, and purposeless, just hung about. Visits to the Mars that never was, where the would-be warriors were reincarnated fully, were short and expensive, and attempts to steal additional power from town were met with polite but firm objections by the local constabulary. The reborn raced each other in their sand buggies across the desert. They hopped the short-haul trains between Yen of Town and Port Jessup and jumped off without paying. They went detecting for old junk in the desert to sell for scrap, and sometimes they met up with other reborn in great conclaves, out where not even the trains went. And there they drank too much water of life and held tournaments where they battled each other in feats of strength. Dowd, in truth, had begun to find the whole thing uninspiring. The problem was there was nowhere else to go. He sat on the caravan's porch, behind the thin stretched acrylic glass, and watched the horizon. Even the sunsets weren't all that. He heard sunsets on Earth were spectacular affairs. But Earth was closer to the sun. Here, the sunsets just sort of went gray on the horizon. At night, he loved watching the lights in the sky, of which Earth was just another dot. But up there, visible as light in the sky, moved spacecraft, habitats, satellites. Life. More glamorous and exciting than anything the Outback had to offer. Up there, sophisticated people sat right now in a floating bar drinking fancy cocktails in bulb-like containers, watching the world spin below as they chased the day. Looking down on him, not even knowing there was a place called Yen of Town, not caring either. He'd grown up in town, had fallen for a visiting troop of reborn warriors from Tongyun, who traveled from town to town with a Kawamata deck, offering anyone the chance to see Mars that never was for themselves, for a small price. He paid the admission, was astonished to find himself in Mars as it never was, but could have been a wild, ancient, beautiful world, with its water-filled canals where four armed warriors built a great civilization under the direction of the Emperor of Time. For most people, a glimpse was just that, a moment's entertainment, followed perhaps by a shrug. There were many games worlds in the conversation, after all. One could immerse oneself in the guilds of Ashkelon universe and pilot spaceships at warp speed and trade with aliens. People did. People lived and worked in the virtuality every day of their lives. But Mars That Never was different. It was real, not a simulation. It was not run inside the conversation. It was not hosted off some deep, buried core. It really was Mars, the way it was, or could have been, or could still be. At least, that's what they said. Dowd followed the troop to the next town, and the next. He slept rough, went hungry, did odd jobs, and begged until he got the money to pay for another glimpse. After a while, the Reborn accepted him as an apprentice. By the time he got back to Yanifetown, he had begun the surgery that turned him into a warrior. Two new arms grafted onto his body to join the existing ones, his skin tinted red, his muscles bulging and his height greater. He was now called T-P-I-E. Eventually, he and the others moved out of town into their little camp. They had their own Chiaki deck. He still loved going into the real Mars, even if it never was. But the Mars of the physicality was dull and dusty. His only real friend from school, Jibril Todd, became the station master at the small train station, and they never spoke anymore. What was there to say? Jibril had a real life, as mundane as it was, and Dowd, T-P-I-E, was still waiting for something to happen. He watched without much curiosity as a small figure appeared over the horizon, moving slowly across the desert sands. The figure had not drawn much attention at first. Wanderers across the exposed surface weren't as rare as they once were. Since the earliest days of human exploration and settlement, things moved on land and in the air of Mars. Robots at first, then buggies, when the first humans arrived in their jalopies on the one-way trip to Terminal. Then the giant Hongyuns began to lay down cities. The railways were built, and the buggies turned into proper long-distance cars. And in the outback especially, there was usually someone or something drifting in the desert. Robots or suited humans or reborn, looking for something to do. Only the other day, Dowd had run into a Robotnik, an old cyborged Earthborn ex-soldier, metal detecting for scrap. What was his name? Mendel. That was it. Mendel the Robotnik. Dowd hadn't met a Robotnik before. He barely met anyone interesting. Small town life meant stability. The same faces every day. He and Jibril often talked, back when they were children, of hopping the train one day and just leaving. Finding a place in Tongyun, with its teeming crowds, or going even farther to the up and out. But it turned out Jibril just liked trains, and so he worked at the station, and as for Dowd, he wasn't sure what he wanted. The big city seemed scary to him. It was easier to be alone in a crowd. In town, he knew everyone. Even now that he was reborn and augmented, to them, he was just little Dowd, like he always was. There was something both comforting and mortifying about it. He got off the porch, put on a suit, custom-made for the forearmed, strapped on an oxygen tank and stepped out of the makeshift airlock. The figure in the distance grew closer, but didn't approach the reborn encampment. Dowd, curious now, hopped over. A small, rotund man in a life support suit much like Dowd's smiled at him cheerfully from behind the clear glass visor of his helmet. Behind him came an extraordinary caravan, beat up and together with conflicting parts that looked like they were salvaged in a junkyard. It made even the reborn camp look like a shiny metropolis in comparison. The caravan self-driving came to a half a little way away and stopped. "Hello," Dowd said. "Hello to you, too," the man said. He went to the back of the caravan, opened the doors onto a non-pressurized storage area, and began lugging out heavy equipment. "Give me a hand. Or four." "Sure," Dowd said. He was bemused by this apparition. He went to help the man offload equipment. "What's it for?" Dowd said. "Digging." "Digging what?" The man paused and looked at Dowd in evident surprise. "Gnell," he said.
"Ah,
name's Bloom. I'm a Blaumilch."
"Ah."
Blaumilches dug canals. Everyone knew that. No one quite knew why. It was some old earthing.
"What did you think I was doing here?" Bloom said.
"You thought I was crazy or something?"
"No, no. Just curious, that's all."
"Reborn, huh?" Bloom said. He looked at Dowd up and down critically.
"There are the canals of the mind," he said sagely.
"And then there are canals of the soul."
"Aha," Dowd said.
"You got a name, warrior?"
Bloom said.
"T-P-I-E," Dowd said. "But you can call me Dowd. I don't mind."
"That's your birth name, huh?"
Bloom said.
"Well, help me lug this drill out, will you?"
Dowd grunted as the drill emerged bit by bit out of the storage area.
"A little help, Moocher, please,"
Bloom said. The caravan shuddered, then dropped axle. The drill rolled out and Dowd got out of the way just in time before being crushed.
"Thank you,"
Bloom called out cheerfully.
"Don't mention it,"
the caravan said. It had the voice of an old hobo, the sort of rough-voiced ancient as played by Shurkin Goodbye in any number of Phobos Studios productions. Sunset on Olympus, Last Train to Tharsis, The Man Who Lived Alone in a Crater and Finally Found Love, etc.
"Moocher, is it?" Dowd said.
"What's it to you, fella?" the caravan said.
"Nothing, nothing," Dowd said, just making conversation.
"Dowd is helping us, Moocher," Bloom said. "Be nice."
"I wasn't always a caravan, you know," Moocher said. "I used to be a toaster."
"A toaster, huh?"
Dowd said.
"On Earth."
"What was that like?" Dowd asked.
"Well, you know. You put bread in, you pop it out hot. That sort of thing. Quite satisfying. Got bored after a few years, then I was a spaceship in Jovian space during the war."
"A spaceship?" Dowd said, impressed.
"Well, a mine. I was a mine, you got me. Just floating there waiting for something to hit me. I never did get to explode, didn't see any action, really. Only from a distance. Then after a decade or two, I got decommissioned. Couldn't figure out what I wanted to do. Almost became a lift."
There was a shudder in his voice.
"A lift? Can you imagine it? Going up, going down."
"I found Moocher in a second-hand shop on level 5 in Tongyun," Bloom said. "Just above the Solwota Blong Sitsit. You know, the sewers."
"The Sea of Refuse. Sure," Dowd said.
"Miles long, sunless sea. They say all kinds of things live down there. Anyway, their Moocher was broken and useless. He was a toaster again, only his coils had burned out."
"I didn't care for it. I was trying to become a poet."
"You weren't bad either. What was it? Taim mi stop long, space mi haram sabe, kawe de blong od star."
"When I was in space, I knew and understood the silence of stars?" Dowd asked.
"Good, isn't it?" Bloom said proudly. "Anyway, I dug Moocher out and said, listen, pal, you can stay here and this sits it, or you could come work with me."
"And I said, sure. What, the 9 billion hells?"
Moocher said.
"That's nice," Dowd said.
"Can be, can be." Then the caravan stilled its engines and didn't speak again.
"Resting," Bloom said. "Travel a long way to get here. Push."
"What?
Push!"
Together, Dowd and Bloom pushed the drill into a lot of empty sand. Cable snaked out from the drill into the caravan. Bloom examined the horizon, examined the ground, made vague surveyor gestures with his fingers, shrugged, and said,
"Well, thanks for the help, but I better get to work."
"Sure," Dowd said. He took a few steps back. Bloom seemed to have forgotten all about Dowd. He held on to the drill. The machine came to life. The roar echoed in the thin atmosphere. It came at Dowd from outside the suit. Sand and clay and dust and rocks flew into the air. Dowd took several hasty, more steps back. Bloom. Doug.
Bloom dug. As the day lengthened, some evidence of his work began to be seen. From an initial untidy hole in the sand, the fracture in the soil extended. Now a rudimentary trench extended from ground zero toward the horizon. Bloom kept whistling cheerfully all the while, the sound broadcast on the nearby channels of the conversation. One by one and two by twos, people came out to watch. First to appear were Dowd's fellow reborn, drawn by the noise and the clouds of sand. They stood and watched for a while, then dragged over a large tent which they inflated and hooked up to an atmospheric generator. After that was done, they went inside and sat on folding chairs, watching the Blaumilch as they sipped their beers. Next, a transport caterpillar, bringing back the workers from the nearby Ideity factory, rolled by. Drawn by the commotion, inside were Jelena Golden and Ludmila Hassan and Malka Darwish, and they stared out of the windows and waved to the reborn. Eventually, the driver was persuaded to inflate the emergency bubble, and the girls went outside. After some fiddling with suits and materials, an air corridor was put up between the two tents. More people came out of Yaniv town to see what was going on. They came by buggies or in trucks, and behind them came an old robot, R. Ripperim Olgud, who had shown up in town off the train some time back and since then hung around on some sort of pilgrimage, the robot said. Dowd, who was still in his suit and standing apart from the others, found himself next to the robot as they contemplated hatching. I visited New Venice once, in the North Pole, the robot said. It's where the first Blaumilch started all those years ago, or so they say. A complex network of canals where water flows during the summer months. Quite beautiful, they say. I was there in winter, in the total dark. I found it an eerie place. The canals were frozen, and all one could see were the stars. I always look for Earth up there. I don't know why. It's only a tiny dot of light, but it used to be home. You're Dowd, aren't you? It's T-P-I-E now, Dowd said, but either works. I see, forgive me. I am R. Ripperim Old Good, but you can call me Rip. You saw the pole? Dowd said. I've never been much farther than Enid. I would have liked to have seen New Venice. Travel is what one does, either to have something to tell when they return home, the robot said, or something one does because they have no home to return to. Do you have a home? The robot considered. I used to, it said. The problem with getting so old is that the world shifts around you. I guess I am still searching for where I belong. I can understand that, Dowd said. I have not been sure myself, recently, of where I fit into things. He took a breath. I went to the Mars I never was last week to seek the advice of the Oracle in the Crystal Cave. I'm sorry, the robot said. I'm not familiar with that term. Oh, Dowd said. It is, well, it's a mythic oracle who lives in a crystal cave in the mountains of time, on the slopes below the Emperor's palace. I see. The Pirin, the Emperor's messenger birds, flock above the cave in great numbers. They could sense my doubt, I think. They cried out to me and called me rude names. The inside of the cave was dark. Candles burned in alcoves, and it smelled of burning fat. The Oracle was a small, squat figure, spider-like, with 13 eyes. But she would not answer my questions, and I came away still not knowing. If you still believe, the robot asked. You understand? Dowd said, surprised. Us robots have been seeking faith for a long time. I understand doubt. Is it really real? Dowd said. I feel as though me and the others, I mean, just keep doing the same thing, and for what? There must be something else out there. I thought old Mars would make me whole, but I am still just myself. It is hard to escape one's essential nature, the robot said. Look at the Blaumilch, though. Bloom, he seems happy. He knows what he wants. He knows what to do. He wants to dig canals in the desert, the robot said. That is hardly a...
Yes.
That was an unkind thought I was going to voice, the robot said. Forgive me. Perhaps it isn't so much the canal, but the digging that is the point.
Dowd nodded. More tents had been put up, and he saw Maya Kuri from the Izikaya had put up her large events bubble, and sleeves now connected it with the other tents. A party was in progress. The impromptu gathering resembled an ant warren. There had been no ants on Mars, not until humanity began to settle like dandelion seeds on the hostile sands. Ants and bugs and insects made the crossing from Earth to Mars. Space-born explorers planting tiny flags on other worlds. Thou'd like ants. There were no ants in Mars that never was, of course. But he liked them in real life. And this was the problem, he reflected. He had begun to think of the physicality as the real world and not of the world where he was the reborn warrior to Pi'ai. He used to get such strength from it, an existence, an identity. But not recently. He looked in envy at the Blaumilch, digging. The man never seemed to tire. The trench, this would be canal, extended into the distance.
Humph, the robot said. Then it turned away and walked back to town.
The next day, the party was over. Dowd surveyed the abandoned site, where boot prints in the sand and the impressions left by tents were all that remained. That and the debris, litter from the makeshift festivities, was half buried in the piles of sand and sediment left by the dig. Bloom himself had vanished somewhere into the distance. His trench had been extended overnight, its walls shored up, its bottom deepened. The caravan, too, had moved. It was visible distantly on the horizon. Dowd watched. For the moment, there was no cloud of dust visible. Perhaps Bloom was finally resting. He went into the small chapel, plugged into the Kawamata Chiaki deck. Translation was instant. He was reborn under a pale red sky, found himself walking through green new shoots out on the prairies. On the nearby Grand Canal, boats piloted by four-armed warriors sailed on sparkling blue water. Ahead of him, framed dramatically against the sky, were the mountains of time, peaked with snow, the dark shapes of the Pi'rin flying in the air over the slopes. The air smelled fresh and clean. The sun was warm on T.P.I.E.'s skin. He followed the Grand Canal, walking along the bank, where tiny flowers bloomed purple under his feet. This was Mars, as it never was, as it could have been. A four-armed girl came and joined him, and they walked hands in hands across the meadow to a bonfire that burned by the canal. Hands in hands, they walked, and the sun shone in the sky, and the flowers released a mildly intoxicating scent that made T.P.I.E.'s limbs heavy and relaxed. The fire burned warm, and the smell of the wood it burned was like no smell that had ever existed on that strange third planet from the sun that was nothing but a dot of light in the night sky. He reached for the girl, and their lips touched an electric and an electrifying kiss. As...
Man, you're hogging all the power, someone said.
Dowd was rudely awakened back in the chapel. Bonfire was gone, the scent of the flowers, the warmth of the girl.
Yeah, sorry, he mumbled.
His fellow reborn, Kalanga, pushed him, not roughly, and said, we're all out of solar and the backup generator's out.
Yeah, all right, Dowd said.
He got up, the images fading, the Mars that never was leaving him, as it always did, feeling washed out and vexed in some vague way, the come down from a sugar high that bleached color and left only the real world's muted browns and tans. The sand was golden, but it was just sand.
I'm going for a walk, Dowd said. We still have oxygen, at least, don't we?
Hey, man, Kalanga said, raising both sets of arms up in a defensive posture. I didn't pull you out of there. You know I would never do that, but the power's out.
Yeah, I know. I just need some...
Dowd faltered.
What, he thought.
What did he need? He had no idea. Something else. Something new. A change. He put on his suit without thinking, his hands moving through the rhythm of checking the seal's internal heat, connecting the oxygen supply. Outside was hostile, and he would never get to walk through a meadow in the sun holding hands with a girl. Not as long as he lived on Mars. Mars as it actually was, with an endless desert, the tiny boring dome towns,
the crisscross ant trails of the railway tracks. But he didn't know another world. He stepped out of the airlock, his boots making boot prints in the sand. The newly dug trench stretched away from the reborn encampment into the horizon. He could see a cloud of dust, bloom awake, and digging again. Dowd began to walk along the trench, listening to the howling of the wind, imagining the trench when it was finished, filled up with heavily salinated water that wouldn't freeze or evaporate. There was plenty of ice water on Mars under the surface, regularly mined and processed. The Blaumilches were odd, no doubt. Some said that they were a religion, that they believed in no god. Others said that they were a spiritual movement, or a philosophy, or just a trend. But Dowd began to realize Blaumilches were none of those things. He thought they just liked to dig. He saw Moocher in the distance, and the small figure that was Bloom, still on his drill, raising clouds of sand and ice as he extended his not-yet canal. Dowd walked, and he came to the two of them, and there he stopped.
"You again," Moocher said. "What do you want this time?"
"Nothing." His heart beat fast in the cage of his chest. His hands felt clammy in their gloves. "Nothing," he repeated softly when he meant everything. Bloom stopped digging, turned his head, saw him, and grinned. "T-P-I-E, right?" he said. "It's Dowd," Dowd said.
"Right, right. Well, what? What are you waiting for, fella? You want to take it for a spin?"
Dowd stood very still. He heard the blood beating in his ears. The sudden silence with the drill stopped. He thought he had heard the mocking cries of Pierin flying high overhead. They weren't real. They were birds that never were in a Mars that never was. This Mars was. On this one, a tiny little baby was born one day, was named, was loved, was raised in a domed town deep in the outback where nothing ever happened, nothing but people living their lives. He let out a breath. He didn't know he had.
"Can I?" "Go on, fella. You know what they say. Four hands are better than two if you want to get a job done. Give it a try."
Bloom pressed a button on the digger, and two new handles popped out. Then he went and stood by the caravan and watched Dowd with that same amused, infectious smile that said he was just happy to be there. Dowd smiled too. He realized then it was the first time he had smiled in a long time. He went to the digger. He took up the handles. The digger felt good in his hands. Heavy. Solid.
"Why do you do it?" he said to Bloom. "I just like to dig."
"Yeah," Dowd said. He took a deep breath. Then he pressed down with all his muscle and the digger roared to life. A cloud of sand and ice and dust rose into the thin atmosphere, engulfing him. Dowd screamed joy into the storm. What are your thoughts on the story? You can leave us a comment over at the Clarkesworld Magazine website if you go to the About Us page. All of our contact information is listed there. We have a bunch more stories to bring you for the month of October, so I do hope you can come back and listen should you so choose. And until then, my dear listener, I bid you a very fond and hopefully very temporary farewell.